competitors. From California, Rick Grizzly Brown, the 30-stone giant with a personality to match. From Austria, Klaus Wallace, judo expert and the current European pro wrestling champion. From Finland, Ilkka Niemisto, former Olympic canoeist, and at 42, the oldest competitor. From Toronto, Dusko Markovic, the Canadian Highland Games champion and undercover drugs cop. From Lille, Jean-Pierre Brulois, the 4-time French powerlifting champion and on home ground. From Reykjavik, John-Paul Sigmason, charismatic showman and last year's runner-up. From Rotterdam, Ab Wolders, the tough powerlifter, back in business after serious injury. And the man they'll all have to beat, Jeff Capes, the world's strongest man. They come to Nice on the Riviera, which is easy on the eye, hard on the checkbook, yet delightful in the winter sunshine. At the height of the season, tourists flock down Nice's proms in their thousands. The first tourists were the ancient Greeks, who made full use of the natural harbour. The Romans dallied here too and bequeathed its style. Then in the 30s, the English began a long affair with Nice, consummated sometimes in opulent exile. But there's nothing more relaxing than the waters of the Med as you think of loved ones back home, staving off frostbite. Anyway, it's the stuff dreams are made of. The charming old town was made for getting lost in. You can forget the guidebook in there, and if you're lucky, you won't find your way out easily. Nice, of course, is a flower city, and the Marché aux Fleurs is one of the most colourful markets in the world. Seems a pity to disturb them, but they are. Not easily, though, for these tough traders would have parking meters for the bees if they could get away with it. But the lure is irresistible. And voila! On certain days, the market becomes an antique centre. With everything from a non-singing Maurice Chevalier to gramophones with laryngitis. And even the guard dog exhibits a fondness for the heavy lunch. Cordon bleu or crafty cognac, temptations abound.
You know, a famous Hollywood producer once said, you can't film adjectives. Well, we all know what point he was trying to make. Except when you come here and you point a camera down at the very famous
Promenade des Anglais,
you suddenly realize he only gets away with that point by the benefit of a doubt, because looking down there reminds you of all the very kind adjectives that have been used about one of the most famous seafronts in the world, but is very busy with traffic. It takes you about half an hour to cross it. The problem for the big men, though, is not the busy traffic. It's a truck, a static truck, which needs a helping hand.
6.5 tons of sullen menace, but they won't remain passive for long as they're hauled man against man down the 20 meters track. And as you can tell from sea and sky, the weather is on everybody's side. Jeff Capes, the current world's strongest man, at 37, this will be his last appearance in the event. It's easy to conclude he wants to go out at the top. Sigmason is his strongest contender.
I have a very big problem over there. 170 kilos of problem. Jeff Capes.
First to go, Grizzly Brown, the man with wall-to-wall shoulders and a friend to all. Klaus Wallace from the world of wrestling and judo, in which he was a world military champion.
Klaus Wallace and Grizzly Brown, on your mark, take the strain.
In this first event for the DAF Trucks Trophy, the tight control of the rope is essential, but you can see the slack in both lanes, although the Austrian is just beginning to get the better of this. This is probably faster than anybody really expected, and both of them enjoying the benefits of great arm strength. And the trucks are unused to traveling this fast on the fronts at Nice anyway. But the Austrian, the winner by almost 6 seconds. And perhaps a little premature to start yodeling yet. Dusko Markovic, or as he's known in Toronto, Desperate Dan. Jean-Pierre Brulois, the local hero, much heavier than he was last year, but still boys compared to the others. We'll now see if all that extra bulk will benefit the Frenchman. He has, of course, the bulk of the support. And indeed, it's the Frenchman who's edging ahead. The truck on the seaward side doesn't seem quite as frisky. And Brulois is the winner in 21.9.3 behind Wallace, although he and his tattoos seem genuinely pleased. For Desperate Dan, it's also news.
Where do you think you'll end up in this competition now you've got the first event over?
I'd like to make it in the top five. Just like anybody else, I'd like to win it. But as I said, these people have a lot more experience, and you get guys like Jeff Capes, John Paul Sigmarsson. I mean, you know, they're animals, so they really are.
Ilka, Namisto, and John Paul Sigmarsson, to your marks. Take the strain.
Now, I wouldn't call Sigmarsson an animal without a getaway helicopter parked at my elbow. Mark you, the 42-year-old Finn is really pushing him surprisingly close. There's only the thickness of a tread in it. But it's Sigmarsson's by 0.3 of a second, the fastest time so far. And already the oldest man has impressed. And what do you think of it so far, John Paul? And that was a screwed down table too, for a man whose wind down's actually terrifying. Meanwhile, boy meets girl.
Give him a kiss. Give him a kiss.
And Jeff Capes in his last World's Strongest Man Championship is about to meet the truck. The Dutchman, Ab Walders, is opponent in the seat. Now, realistically, Capes is the only one likely now to better Sigmarsson's time. And Jeff is into this as if he's pulling a king's ransom towards him. And being the first event, he seems to realize the psychological effect on himself and the others if he can start off on a high note. Indeed, he's treating the truck as if it was a toy. And with Walders trailing, Capes flattens himself out, 0.2 ahead of Sigmarsson. And Walders with a good time. After Seeley's hand injury, people had written Ab off.
There's a bit of a challenge in as much as you felt that people thought you were finished.
I don't know if people thought I'm finished, but if they thought it, then I would show them otherwise.
But Capes at the top, Sigmarsson only that single point behind, and the others, particularly Numisto, the dark horse in third place, look as if they have to be serious contenders.
Well, I'm sure most of us have taken part in a sack race at some stage in their life, but not a sack race like this one here. Look at this harness, which looks like a giant's girdle, stout piece of rope, and in the sack, 32 stones of wet sand. All adding up to an event like this.
Yes. And this event starts as a pain in the neck, with a sack of sand making an unlikely scarf round the competitors. Walders and Wallace, the first two, have to carry it down the 50-meter course and then replace it with a sack double the weight of the other end. It certainly isn't recommended treatment for slipped discs, and Walders, who himself has come back to these events after that injury, shows that his spirit is willing and sore his legs. Now, a slick changeover can save a second or two. And those proficient at putting their trousers and braces on in the dark are at a distinct advantage. Now, with a harness provided, the temptation is to lean back and use the thighs as a principal force. Remember, there seems enough sand in there to fill the road hole bunker at St. Andrews. It is a torturous 50 meters. The Austrian Wallace hasn't really come to terms with the technique. Anyway, by the look of it, he takes a size smaller than the harness. Inelegant, but survivable. Well, this is where the coaches begin to pay their way. The voice must bring some kind of comfort. Klaus Wallace looks as if an invisible force is pushing him the wrong way. The barrier seems too much. Only a few feet in it, the worst few feet. The whole sack, of course, is to cross the line. And he's done it in 2 minutes, 43.2, but at what great cost. And Klaus's helping hand is in recognition of how punishing the event is.
Looking at them normally, I wouldn't like to swap places with you, except no, for this delightful physiotherapist as well. What's the problem?
Well, it's the age-old problem in my shoulder, and the trap's just getting tight after exertion. I mean...
Yeah, this has been a chronic one with me.
It's always been a chronic one, and it'll never get better. I mean, it's been like this for 7 or 8 years, and some days it's good, some days it's bad, you know.
This next event entails lifting very heavy sacks. Will you feel it then?
Well, I have a theory. I think I'll kick myself on my leg and make that hurt more than that, and then go for it. But obviously, you know, without pain, there is no gain. Without pain, there is no glory.
Capes' very careful preparation. Next, the Finn against the American.
Right here. On your marks and get set.
Grizzly has the weight all right, but in this event, he is no Carl Lewis. Namisto is the oldest man in the tournament, and unlike Samson, he kept his strength when he lost his hair. And with his kind of pace, he must be making disturbing viewing for Capes and Sigmason. Now, this is the bit of the turn Grizzly will really like, reminding him of what he does in the wrestling ring. The Finn is electing for the long rope, so it doesn't look as if he's suffered so far. Namisto didn't even have time to say cheerio in passing Grizzly the other way. And the affable American is toiling. Namisto's coach senses a very good time as he belts it out in Finnish. And with the crowd sharing the support for him, if he can drag himself in quickly, he'll end up with a splendid time, which he does in 1 minute 39.6, which puts him well in the lead. Grizzly alone, if you don't count sympathy coming from all sides. Backing towards the palatial but indifferent hotels of Nice, he's given it everything, but it's not getting through now to those huge muscles. Big men like Grizzly exhibit a special kind of misery when the body they've tutored so avidly fails a test like this, and especially when he knows the crowd are on his side.
The old ticker going, like the clappers, Grizzly.
You better believe it, brother. You know, we'd have the doctor here. The old Grizz would have fell out with a very serious cardiac arrest.
But out there, they're catching fish in a view of men almost going over the top. Jeff Capes, this first section will be to his advantage. And Brewer will have to try and match Jeff's great speed over the ground. The young Frenchman is being left behind by an exhilarating surge by Capes. Surprisingly, though, Brouillard picked up near the end, and they're about all square at the turn. But Capes obviously knows a thing or two about stepping into a harness and has left Brouillard behind in the traps. Well, at this stage, Capes looks fairly comfortable. He's practiced hard at this event, and it looks as if it's paying off for him now. He's also smooth. Oh, he didn't want that part touching the ground. And Mark Higgins, his coach, knows just how much to scream at him. Well, that fall has broken the momentum of the pool, apart from losing him seconds. Well, that unfortunately stems from even Capes getting tired. But he's done it in a very impressive 1 minute 15.8, although his huge frame has suffered. Brouillard is nearing his limit. But he does know when enough is enough, and a sprightly-looking Sigmason in the background acknowledges his efforts.
How did you feel before the event when you saw all the agony around you of all the other competitors?
I don't really know. I think one of all, really, because when you see guys who are physically fit, just kind of hitting a wall and changing colour.
Yeah. Won't it be interesting to see how they recover in the different ways?
Yeah. It will show who's reasonably fit and who isn't at the end of the competition.
It's kind of a...
How do you feel now
hitting
yourself?
Hitting the wall and changing colour, to say the least.
With all that pain around, Sigmason looks remarkably relaxed. He goes against Dusko Markovic, the Toronto cop.
On your marks, get set!
On speed, nothing much to choose at the moment. Sigmarsson's first to the turn, though, and quicker with the harness. He shortened the length of the rope like capes, and that seems to be the right method. Dusko's well behind. Rhythm, that's what John Paul has. He also has some sack to pull. Signs of a tired man there. It's very quick, even though there are more than traces of a struggle now in Sigmarsson. But he's over in an astonishing 1 minute 6.4 and grateful for the lie down. Only a couple of yards to go for Markovic. No, the time limit is up, but the new boy has put himself into fourth place.
I am the Viking.
Vikings seem to feel no pain. How about Canadians?
Well, I'll tell you, it was so bad. If you looked at the definition of word bad in the dictionary, my picture would probably be there. It was pretty bad.
Sigmarsson's event, all right. Good control, fine attack, Cape's not all that far behind, and the growing champion of the middle-aged Numisto belying his age. Overall score count after two events, Cape's and Sigmarsson neck and neck with 15 apiece, followed by Numisto, worrying the big two.
Well, the next event is a very classic and ancient test of strength. The lifting of very heavy stones. In this particular instance, taking this stone and putting it into that barrel. There are five barrels in all. An expert in it is referee David Webster. This is a very ancient practice, David.
Yes, going back to the Middle Ages, when it was a test of manhood to put a big boulder like this, slightly smaller, of course, onto a wall at waist height. So this duplicates that feat exactly.
Do you often get five stones put in the barrels?
Never. Never has been done in a competition. One competitor only has lifted this big stone before.
And this is the man who did it, John Paul Sigmarsson. Now we've moved inland a little to the pleasant Parc d'Albert. The stones have come by road 2,000 miles from Scotland. They're called the McGlashan Stones.
Austria, on your mark and get set.
The current European wrestling champion Klaus Wallace is off with the first stone, weighing 95 kilos or 209 pounds. Not much strain there, but John Paul will tell you this event has special problems.
The grey on the stones, and also you have to be very careful about your hamstrings, your legs, because you stretch the hamstrings a lot when you try to pick up the stones.
The third stone, 221 pounds, saying it in kilos, 120, doesn't make it any easier. But he doesn't look especially racked putting that in. Now the fourth, 130 kilos. He doesn't much like his belt now. Well, fortunately, nothing has fallen down. On he goes. He's done it. And now the last boulder, which is an unimaginable 22 and a half stone, 3.5 more than his body weight. One way or the other, he isn't likely to forget this. No. No, he'd prefer wrestling, but you can't put a half Nelson on a McGlashan. Next to go, the man currently in fourth place, Ab Walters. And I asked him before the start how much he fancied such an event.
The first one is easy, and then it goes up, and it's getting bigger.
But I've never done it before, so should be fun.
Fun? No sign of giggling as the watches record him at the second barrel. Now for the third one, 120 kilos. He's well ahead of Wallace time at this point. The weight has increased by 46 kilos. And he knows it. And more than half a minute up at the same point. Well, Walters is a nightclub bouncer, and he's done enough to convince me I wouldn't gatecrash one of his parties, but this is the real test. No, it's a wise man who knows when to let a stone gather moss. The Gaelic giant Brulewa found the going too hard and could only manage two stones, much to the disappointment of those who thought he had more in him. And all 30 stone of grizzly could only manage one, which made the bear growl.
I just can't get enough arm around it. You know, it's very, very frustrating. Very frustrating. I'm going to get this. I got to crack him with a mallet.
Not for a stone that looks as if it's been made from steel girders in Scotland. Ilka Namisto prepares himself.
Namisto, on your march and get set.
Let's remind ourselves again that Namisto, making it look easy, should, at his age, be home lifting a gardening trowel. On the other hand, doing it like that wins you lots of friends. The third stone treated almost with contempt. Somewhat heavier is the fourth stone, precisely his own body weight, 130 kilos. The coach thinks he can do it. What an amazing man he is. Now remember, in contemplating the final one, John Paul alone has managed this 140 kilos of dumb resistance. It's in his control, but only just. Oh, there's only the lip between him and triumph. In it goes. The McGlashan stones have been well and truly conquered by a man who might well have gone to pasture by now. Now desperate Dan Markovic. He's not messing about, obviously thinking speed is a virtue. One of the basic problems here is grip. The very smoothness is a handicap. Well, Cape seems to be lifting with him. Oh, Dusko's finding it all a bit much. Oh, he's done it. But that's enough. And obviously, he's not going to sulk. And now the current joint leader, the massively determined Jeff Capes. As Jeff raced on, I asked Dusko how he felt about this.
It looks very simple if you look at it. Just say, well, you know, just a round stone. You know, no problem, but once you get into it, once you start picking it starts sliding down your arms, and you really have to get right into it.
Which is Jeff's philosophy, too. He's on the boil. At this point, he's the fastest so far. Now, the agonizing challenge he's always failed. Stone five. He can't give any more than this. It might be his last chance ever at it. Super! That will give him as much satisfaction as anything he's achieved so far. He's in the lead.
I'm not doing it. I'm very pleased to do all five because I've not done it before.
You seem to gnash your teeth and go really after that. Very determined looking.
I think it's necessary. But now John Paul knows it's also necessary to do it.
To let the folks back home know, he has to beat Jeff's time of 40.2. I think he's responding. He didn't like losing his crown last year. Now he's intent on showing that Capes is living out that title in borrowed time. He certainly started fast, but all the competitors slow down approaching that last stone. And he's beaten Cape by a full 3 seconds.
I am the strong guy! I am the Viking!
The modest Icelander has taken the event by storm. Three lifted five stones. Namisto is impressing even the most experienced. And Sigmason is back to being a favourite for the title.
What about all the shouting and roaring at the people around? What does that do for you?
I have to psych myself, you know, I have to psych myself before the competition, because, you know, Jeff Capes, he did a very good time, and the Finnish guy, he's very, very strong.
Aren't you worried about scaring some of these people when you roar at them?
No, I think they're safe.
Sigmason one ahead, Capes with 22, Namisto close at 18, Walders 14, the rest trailing. Same park, different event. These cars are about to get worse treatment than in the Parisian rush hour. They're to be overturned, and it's a big man who'll be in top gear. But Namisto is making one of the saddest sights in sport, halted in his tracks by an injury in practice. The torn bicep muscle will handicap him. Meanwhile, French kids are becoming honorary Toronto police.
You're a policewoman for a day now.
There you go.
It's always nice for the kids, you know, you got to get a chewing section somehow.
Well, the quiet of the Parc d'Albert is about to be broken man against man. Maximum points to the fastest. The injured Finn, naturally tense. Brouwer favouring gloves.
On your marks and get set.
Well, there's nothing wrong with Namisto's legs, but obviously the arm can't cope. Sadly, he's pulling out. Meanwhile, Brouwer is unscathed and confident. Frenchmen are normally more respectful of their cars than this. The last car, and Brouwer is now in the mood. It's now all in a quick sprint. The time, 32.6. And consolation and treatment for a despondent Finn. Not an event that would likely give John Paul many qualms. Oops! That cannot be for the knacker's yard after that. Well, John Paul might have hurt his leg, but it doesn't show. Well, he really can't get enough of this challenge. You obviously don't need jacks in Iceland. Oh, it's very fast. 22.2. Wallace with a third. Oh, I think he's forgotten there's a finishing line to him. And Capes must appreciate the legwork of Iceland's now most famous panel beater.
Icelandic blood, Viking blood.
Well, it's going to be a very fast event, so losing 2 or 3 seconds is vital.
Yeah, Jeff will be very fast. And Ab Walters too, he is one of the fastest in the world.
Dusko, the tough man with a soft heart. Walders, for whom Sigmason has a high regard.
On your mark and get set!
Difficult to say who touched first there. Certainly the Dutchman's car is off first. John Paul obviously knows his stuff about this man, who clearly has no love for French cars, which are proving stubborn for Dusko. This is very fast indeed. 18.1, and it puts him in the lead. But Dusko could beat Brouwer for fourth place. Yes, 24.6. Now, this is unexpected. Walders has hurt himself, and the injury count in this event is mounting. Grizzly, lifting no problem. Running's another matter. And you can bet Kate isn't going to handle the cars the way he does his budgies.
On your mark, get set!
Faster, Jeff! Told you so. He's after Walders in a big way. Believe you me, that car is no toy. Fast though this is, the final sprint will matter. He's lost none of his well-known speed. He's beaten Walders, but by less than 1 second. Back down the course, Grizzly's in trouble. He seemed to slip and crack his head against the first car. The grass has proved greasy, and not many things put this man on his back.
Looks to me, no, on the grass, a really dangerous event.
No, it's not dangerous. It's like everything else. When you get involved in something like this, no matter what sport it is, you know the injury factor,
you know, there's no problems. It's like skiing, it's like football, it's like motor racing. Don't get involved if you don't want to get hurt.
Grizzly's been shaken. Now they know it wasn't as simple as it looked.
I guess people are starting to realize how tough this stuff is.
Capes first, Walder second, John Paul third, Barkovic fourth, Brewer fifth. An event which certainly took its toll of the competitors, but Capes needed the points. And moving into the evening event, he's chalked up his second win and moved into a one-point lead away from John Paul, both drawing away from Walder's.
You don't need to be a connoisseur to appreciate that champagne gives you pleasure before it gives you pain. Except here, in these beautiful gardens in the middle of Nice, where the competitors are about to face up to the most painful event, the crucifix. It really is agonizing as they hold these two huge bottles of champagne out at shoulder level. Now, these bottles are bigger than Jeroboam's. They're called Methuselah's. And that is appropriate because in holding them out for perhaps over a minute, the competitors are certainly going to age a lot.
For this event, we're in the beautiful Espace Messina, right in the heart of Nice.
Well, that was an unfortunate accident you had this afternoon, Grizzly. Has it demoralized you slightly?
Well, Archie, I'd be lying if I said it didn't take some wind out of my sails this afternoon. But nothing that a good nap and a prayer to God can help me. It'll help me this evening, is what I want to say.
Do you think your back will affect you tonight?
I'm not going to let it affect me tonight. I'm going at it full bore.
Ab Walder's first to go. He has a torn hamstring, but now it's the arms and shoulders which matter. The bottles, remember, weigh 27 pounds each. Well, the referee seems unhappy with the position of Ab's right hand. It appears to be swinging round to the front. It's always a help to know the time. But the referee has penalized him after a second warning for that right arm. And certainly the referee hasn't won any favors with the Dutchman for that decision. And more importantly, Walder's, faced with a moro, is dragging his leg badly. And perhaps they shouldn't risk Numisto. Well, Markovic, the policeman in fifth place, isn't the man to let go a prisoner easily. But then he doesn't hold him up like this. Not officially, anyway. Bit of PR never goes amiss. A Yugoslavian naturalized Canadian and speaking fluent French. He's appealing to everybody. Well, there is a reaction.
Give it a time.
Disguising pain isn't all that easy. Referee telling him to keep the arms back. That's it, though. He also infringed the rules by bringing his arm forward. But it's a good time, just a fraction over 1 minute. But Numisto could only manage 12.7, and Klaus Wallace, the Austrian, found that this event was not to his liking and could only register 18 seconds. Capes is never without support, and he'll need it in an event he positively loathes.
Come on!
Okay,
Jake,
looking good. Squeeze the triceps.
5 seconds!
Squeeze the triceps, Jeff. Come on.
Mark Higgins has stayed close to Capes throughout. His presence is badly needed here. Capes, who has a chronic shoulder weakness, is hating champagne by the second. That tremor is a bad sign. It's only 25 seconds, but he's beaten Wallace and Numisto, but that old shoulder injury has left him weakened there. And into the spotlight, the man who loves it. Except you don't need to be a masochist to build up for this. It's simply John Paul's way.
Now remember not to bring the arms forward, keep your hips back, and go over the bottles at the end.
Okay. Now John Paul prefers mobile events, but since he's fond of winning, he'll not flinch. Now he's either thinking of drinking champagne afterwards, or Miss Iceland, or even both. His left arm is appealing for help, but the trainer's voice is all he has. Well, that's a human side of him. He does suffer like the rest. The argument is between mind and body. and he succumbs, but in a marvellous time of 1 minute 11.3, a new competition record. All the world's a stage to John Paul. He sees that body of his reflected in the enthusiasm of the crowd. Grizzly's concerned by that. Remember, he took a bad knock earlier in the day. Next to go, a man who's no stranger to champagne, Jean-Pierre Brulois. Jean-Pierre competed in this competition for the first time last year, when he found himself right out of his depth. This year, he's certainly tougher. Kind words from Walders, endurance by Brulois. But he's with Brulois, not really against him. And the Frenchman is surprising everybody. But he's gone. The time, 1 minute, 11.1, a mere 0.2 of a second less than Sigmason. The French are delighted. The massive form of Grizzly Brown in position. He broke the competition record for this event last year, so he's got to be strongly fancied, although everybody seems to be pressing him more closely.
Lower, lower.
Before he went out, I asked him how he blocked out the pain.
I think of the things that bring me the most joy in my life and my family. You see, I think of God and my family. How corny that sounds, I don't care.
Nothing theatrical about that yell. You could say he's calling for mercy. Now is the time to prove his great store of dogged courage. He's done it. He's beaten John Paul by just under a second. Relief gained, pride restored.
Give me the time right now!
I suspect they'll give him the answer quickly. Sharing and caring is just part of the brotherhood. Maximum points at last for Grizzly and John Paul again second, but Jeff way down behind Brulois and Markovic. And to Grizzly the spoils. That bottle isn't weighing 27 pounds now. This is Grizzly's idea of a normal shampoo and set.
Confident as
frankly, nobody begrudges the man winning the event.
Back very strongly.
And if he got his head on that car now, he'd probably come out smiling. So Sigmason increasing his lead, but Cape still challenging with Ab Walders and Dan Markovic in third and fourth places, but the first two are drawing away.
3 points ahead, John Paul. Do you think you can win back the title?
I don't think that I can win the title. I am going to win the title.
As confident as that.
Yeah.
But you know what Jeff Capes is like? He can fight back very strongly.
Yeah. You see, tomorrow I'm going to fight too.
A new day dawns, and thankfully the delights of the Riviera haven't vanished overnight. For relaxation is Villefranche quayside, just a few kilometers away. Gourmet's berth here in Linger. Jean Cocteau did and left his fresco in gratitude. Villefranche at this time of the year soothes the nerves. And over there on the peninsula of Cap Ferrat, there are some of the world's strongest safes. Many distinguished writers and artists have set up home there, as well as the exiles from showbiz. Splendid mansions vie with each other for views of the harbor of Saint-Jean, which moors only the elite sea traffic. There's a fortune in boats here. But you know, if you can afford a seafront like this, you can afford anything. It's the third and last day. It's 8:30 of the morning. And as Nice Harbour down there delightfully wakens up, I can assure you, the competitors are fully awake. Some of them have been for the last couple of hours, because they are aware of a very tough and agonising day in front of them.
Now there are three events today.
And a very interesting first event. Notice the boats down there, the yachts, some of them very lovely indeed with ropes. But the rope that we have in mind, you couldn't tie a reef knot with.
Well, hardly, because this is the tug of war, and it's obviously very hard in the arms. And I asked the competition doctor if Ilka Numisto could possibly carry on.
No, I think it's better I stop today. It's his arm is very bad, but it don't want.
And that's cruel on the Finn, who earlier showed such promise. Ab Walders also had to withdraw. I mean, joined him with Grizzly against John Paul. Now, if Grizzly can beat John Paul, it would help Jeff's cause in closing that three-point difference. And Grizzly, you would think, his huge weight must be an advantage. But Grizzly's down, and rules dictate he must get up quickly. Doesn't he look better in champagne? Well, he was hoping that his success last night would act as a spur to improve his position with this event today. But a consoling hand from the victor, John Paul, who's looking stronger by the minute. But it means that Grizzly could only make sixth place, one ahead of the injured Walders. Another bout between the two experts in this game. Jeff Capes is reckoned to be almost unbeatable in man-to-man tug-of-war. But the Canadian Highland Games champion is no slouch either, and this could be interesting.
Take the strain! Take the strain! Oh, stop!
Well, yes, I think David Webster stopped the bout because in his excitement, Jeff jumped the gun and started pulling just a fraction before the whistle blew. There's a look of "don't do that again to me, brother" on Dusko's face.
Take the strain!
Well, Jeff's sheer power and good technique literally swept the Canadian off his feet, and the title holder is looking impressive. Normally, people simply feast the eye in the harbour, but the counter attraction on the quay has a lot going for it.
John Paul Simonsson of Iceland, Jean-Pierre Roubaix of France.
Well, it would appear that Monsieur Brouwer isn't too keen on early morning dips, but a man from Reykjavik has other ideas. This is French synchronized swimming. Well, going in has saved him penalty points. Coming out has saved him pneumonia. Well, at least you can say about these big men, the fun is clean. Now it's the turn of wrestler Klaus Wallace against Jeff Capes, wearing his gunfighter look.
Take the strain.
And again, Jeff turning on that awesome technique and power, but Klaus hasn't disgraced himself. He beats Brouwer earlier, so that means the best result yet, and a very creditable third place for this pleasant Austrian. And now the showdown. Capes versus Sigmundsson. Not looking quite so confident for a change. Jewel in the sun. The personality is as tight as the rope. And Jeff's got him. That's a great result. But there's a tremendous bond between these two, but the big Lincolnshire man's experience made him unbeatable. Confirmation on the board, Jeff's third win, but ominously again, it's John Paul in second place, with Klaus Wallace for the first time in the top three. Overall, 2 points separate Capes from Sigmundsson. Walders and Markovic fight for third, but it's a straight duel for the top.
Well, of course, there's a strong element of entertainment in all of this. That last event proved it. But, you know, the closer you get to these men, the more you begin to appreciate the way they can absorb the cuts, the scrapes, the bruises, and still keep going. And, of course, the two we most admire are Capes and Sigmundsson. Don't let your eye deceive you in this next event, by the way. It's a powerboat lift, but it starts off with a weight of 616 pounds.
Deadlifting has never been one of Jeff's forties, and I asked him if he was apprehensive.
You know, because it's a swan song, so to speak, I'm giving 100% no matter what I do, no matter where I come. It's the 100% effort all the time. I'll be going for him, don't you worry. You know, I'm not going to let him go that quickly.
Jeff Capes has just told me he's not going to let you get away. Now, how much do you admire and respect him?
I respect him a lot. He's a great athlete. And the title is not mine until the end.
Well, Grizzly's back problem was aggravated by the tug of war, and he can't take part in this event, which will obviously favor the power lifters. And this man is in the top echelon. The boat has been sacked with cement and sandbags.
John Paul Sigmundsson, first attempt, 320 kilos.
Berkele. A mere 50 stone or so.
Time. Lift.
Oh. No problem at all. But it seems that John Paul is being disqualified for throwing the boat down, and he doesn't seem to understand the situation. There's clearly a language problem here and some confusion all around. Jeff seems to be explaining to John Paul that by dropping the boat, he infringed the rules and is in serious trouble. The Reykjavik Supporters Club is anxious. But the competition is going on, and John Paul acknowledges the applause for Jeff and the other competitors for allowing him to continue. The spirit of camaraderie prevails again. The weight inside the boat is now 340 kilos, 750 pounds.
Come on!
In your own time, lift!
And the Englishman looked well within himself on that lift, but then he looks like that in most events. All the competitors are allowed six lifts, and this is Dusko's third. It's the same weight, 340 kilos. It's looking tough for him. He must lock out those knees. Well, he made it, but that looked like the limit for him. He's certainly feeling it. The crowd haven't fallen out with him yet, and neither have his French mates.
Next lifter will be Ab Walter.
Come on, take it! Come on!
In your own time...
Hey, Wallace!
Lift!
Back alone! Go on!
His fourth lift, and he's attempting 360 kilos, 795 pounds. He's there. A great achievement by the Dutchman. But his hamstrings must be on fire. And Abruwa, having survived his earlier ducking at the same weight, and also with his fourth lift, and remember, he's been the French powerlifting champion four times.
In your own time, lift!
A very controlled lift, and he's certainly taking no chances with the referee. And that's a good lift by the Frenchman. And now kicks with his fourth lift. The weight is 380 kilos, 59 and a half stone. You know, that summarizes the man well. He's produced the extra nobody but he thought was there. Incredibly, this is only John Paul's third lift. He's saving his strength for the really big weight. He's attempting 400 kilos, that's 63 stone, three times his own body weight. And doesn't that seem very easy? And yet again, he seems to have infringed the rules. David Webster tells him to keep his back straight, and of course, having to lift 400 kilos again means expending a lot more precious energy. Yes, he's there. And he looks like he could even lift the QE2. He is, after all, an entertainer, so he mustn't forget his public. Now then, can Capes possibly stay with him? As I said, he's not known as a lifter. But he's already achieved more than he's done before. A personal best.
Come on, come on.
For lack of technique, substitute willpower. The weight, 420 kilos. 925 pounds, 66 stone. It's not going, and he readjusts his stance as John Paul anxiously watches. Oh, I think you heard that saying no, and that's it. Wisely, he's not risking injury, but another sign that Capes, the champion, will push himself on that bit more than is expected when the chips are down. The weight remains the same, 420 kilos, as John Paul prepares himself. This is his fourth lift, so he's got two more in reserve if he so requires, carefully strapping his wrists.
In your own time!
I wonder if he's in trouble. No, he just delayed it. He loves a victory, doesn't he? What's the use of keeping feeling secret? Anyway, that's his third win, with a remarkable performance by Jeff, beating the powerlifters Brewer and Walders, and also agreeing to allow John Paul to continue. That's now put Sigmundsson 3 points ahead, with only one event to go. And although Jeff will fight to retain his title, Sigmundsson seems to get stronger and stronger.
Well, the competitors are being called for the last event, and I think if there is a little aggro left, it'll help them pump the adrenaline through the veins. This is their last test, the barrel race, or more specifically, wine casks. Five of them, weighing 200 pounds, they go up the steep ramp 20 metres and put them on the lorry. They have to do that five times as quickly as they can. It's an event in which the heart and the lungs are decidedly on overburn.
We've moved along the quayside for an event which has also been hit by injury, and Klaus Wallace has had to pull out. Markovic against Walders. The Dutchman's left leg is merely keeping him company, nothing more, but it's heavily strapped. He's still suffering pain. Markovic is handling the 90 kilos barrel as if it was a 90 kilos barrel. The shake defies a clean hold. Well, the French lesson is understandably brief. You could also have told him the words for agony, pain, exhaustion, and get me out of this. Both of them, surprisingly, think they've had enough. Especially Walders, who'll have to do his nightclub bouncing from a wheelchair for the next month. But Markovic is going to go on, even though the referee has warned Walders that he'll get no points if he doesn't complete another lift. The Canadian is about to go with 310 kilos. He knows it's the last event anyway. So the thought of leaving Nice for a winter in Toronto is enough to make a man try anything. The event doesn't allow for a tea break, though. Just lift 310 kilos of an unyielding barrel, and you can go home with your head held high. That will do. He bowed, except he wouldn't get back up again.
Thank you.
The courtesy call. There could only be one finale. They are quite simply the best.
Jeff Gates of England, John Paul Sigmundsson of Iceland. On your marks and get set. Okay.
You really have to remind yourself constantly that there's a generation of athletic achievement separating these two men. Because they're still so close in competition, we easily forget that it's Capes at the age of 37 who's producing the exceptional. Only a fragile few points separated in contest, yet Capes is giving Sigmundsson 11 years. In accepting this, Capes now has a kind of rugged dignity which John Paul may one day come to appreciate, like the small band of Capes supporters. Sigmundsson, with a second barrel of 90 kilos, is about to draw away. This time he has a good sense not to rub it in by hamming it up. Capes is a genuinely tired man that appears to be no zest. John Paul is now acting as if the rest of the week has been merely a warm-up. Capes looking back not just at an immediate opponent, but at what is now clearly a phenomenal athlete whose clean-limbed strength has maintained the very standards which the big Englishman would wish to endure. Barrel number three. Capes downhill. The length of the course is developing between them, and perhaps Jeff, with his third barrel and still holding on, feels Sigmundsson might make some foolish mistake. It's now the only way the Icelander will go under. But Capes is now beginning to look as if this is his last barrel. Sigmundsson's fourth barrel is on, but now they're companions again. Now the bond of their size and strength is detaining Sigmundsson to will Capes on, for the end apparently is nigh. Capes is finished, but there's enough strength to raise a very important arm in quick recognition of his crown having passed hands. But the new champion has to finish to get maximum score. unless he wishes to do to prove a point. The point being is that he has so much in reserve. His final tactics coming straight from John Wayne at the Alamo. The scores which decided it all. John Paul only a point ahead, but in reality well out in front. Cape second, Markovic finishing stronger than the crippled Walders. And there's ample consolation for the fallen. Wallace's wife screening him. And I ask Grizzly Brown for his thoughts on the final outcome.
I take my hat off to John Paul. He's a tremendous athlete. I take my hat off to everybody. Because you are a good friend of John Paul's, but Jeff is like a brother to me. You never know if it's the end or not. He's a great champion.
One thing I recognize about Jeff Capes, above all else, is that he very carefully thinks his sport. He's very meticulous in the way he examines it.
I said last year, he's the Muhammad Ali of the sport. And brother, you better believe it.
Even on the last event, you see, John Paul was still only 3 points clear. And let's assume, hypothetically, that two of those athletes beat him, I could have won. That's how close it was again. But unfortunately, three athletes dropped out through injury. But the end result was 4 points clear on me. It's a win on his part. You know, he did very well. He took my title again, unfortunately. But in another way, you know, I've got no gripes, no grumbles. I tried my best. And, you know, if my best isn't good enough, then I'd like to see somebody else try my place.
Do you think you can become stronger?
A little bit, Sam.
Yes. I am becoming stronger every year. I am stronger now than last year. And next year, I will be stronger, I promise you.
Is Iceland going to be big enough to hold you?
Yes, I think so. It's a great country.
Well, you're going back with the title. Yeah. World's Strongest Man. Congratulations.
They will all return home with the memories of Nice as a mixture of pleasure and pain, and with the statistics, the mere bones of the immense physical commitment. As Jeff Capes said, there wasn't much between himself and the younger man. The injured Dutchman in third place wasn't disgraced, and the Canadian Markovic impressed as a newcomer. In the light of the day, Nice has composed itself for the presentation of trophies. And these will be handed over by Mr. Corban, member of the Board of Executive Management, DAV Trucks. And there's little danger of John Paul being disqualified for his last lift. After all, he surely deserves the good things in life as the world's strongest man.
I am the team!
Body language. Body language. Body language.
Ha!